I really love the program. I still love the program. And I can honestly say, it really works. I used the training from the program to turn our farm from a barely making it any money to making a nice tidy profit. And it also helped us buy our new 150-acre farm after we sold the old 26-acre farm. Because Matt wanted a couple cows to graze down the grass. We had been borrowing his dad's farm on tractor with a sickle bar mower to mow down the grass. And he said, well, they'll graze it down, we won't mow so much. So what comes along with animals is some fencing. And we didn't have much money, so all of our fence posts were ironwood that we cut off of his father's land. All the fence posts were hand dug. It was quite a bit of work. We had a good time. A few years later, we tried doing some meat chickens, and we really liked them. Actually, the first year they were raised in the barn, they got really huge. They could barely walk. I took them to this old guy out in the city to have him process them, and he said, you know, if you put these guys out on grass, they're going to graze around. They'll be healthier. They'll be better. So the next year, I put them on grass, and he was right. So the cows had always been grass-fed. Huckleberry, the donkey, was already grass-fed. We didn't have any money for the grain, so it was really just, it was an accident, and it was kind of just like common sense. They're going to just graze. So George's steer ended up going to the butcher, and when the beef came back from the butcher, I'm grilling up the steak, and after I ate it, it tasted different. And it was really just like, why? Why does this taste so different? So we had some burgers the next night. It still tasted different. It's like, huh. Well, we also had some laying hens. And the yolks were really orange. And I didn't know any different, so I started researching it. And I'm like, huh, well, isn't that cool? We're actually doing it right. And it tastes better. And you get these bright orange yolks. And the scrambled eggs are phenomenal. And things were going pretty well. And then one spring, I dislocated my knee. And I'm in town at physical therapy, and this woman's on the exercise bike next to me, and we start talking cows. Because at the time we just had Betsy, the Hereford was still there. Well, they have a herd of Highlanders, and they're like 7-8 miles away from us. And Matt had always loved these Highlanders, because, you know, they're cool. We had to drive down the side road, gravel side road, with all the bumps and everything, to go look at these things back in the woods. And so the woman said, we want to sell the herd, and we'd like to find someone that could take over. And they were getting older and having lots of health problems and stuff. So I came home and I said to Matt, well, they want to sell the herd. Do you want to buy a couple? Maybe some young ones. Well, we bought a few more. He said, I want the whole herd. Well, we ended up buying 11. And I had done a little research to find out, what the heck are these big, shaggy, horned, ugly things? And found out, okay, there's some good advertising out there. That, you know, they're supposed to graze really well. They have really easy births. And they're supposed to thrive. They really, I mean, look at the calves. They're just cute. I was kind of sold. George and Betsy, yeah, they were fun and stuff. But these guys, they're cool. So, you know, we get 11 of them. And we get them home, and the moms don't like you. This is a really wild herd. And like the one in the lower corner that's kissing her baby, I called her witchy. On really bad days, she was bitchy. And she wanted to kill you. You go eat her baby, and she was just, they're very protective. We never had a coyote problem, we never had a dog problem. But man, you go to touch that baby to do anything, give it a shot, ear tag it, and you grab it and you run. So we found out after we got them, you know, George and Betsy were a nice little learning experiment. These Highlanders, at times we kind of bit off more than we could chew. We certainly didn't know as much as we should. So we brought them off this hillside pasture that was really down to grass this tall, tons of thistle, tons of rose bush, really not much to graze. We brought them down in our valley on pretty darn lush grass. It was even taller than this. And boom, we got pink eye. And we actually had a calf that actually got an eye injury so bad she lost the eye. So now all of a sudden we got a doctor with these, you know, wild, crazy, untamed beasts. And that was not much fun. And so later on we started figuring out some things, and we were getting small calves, really weak calves. Well, we finally were talking to the previous owners, and we found out the bull that we bought and the cows that we bought, the bull was breeding his daughters. And we didn't know this. So we finally came to the conclusion the bull needs to go. So little bull, who was huge, got replaced by Medler. He's the big black guy at the top with a border collie behind him. So the big stud moved in and things got better. He was really quite tame. We actually have pictures of Matt giving him hugs. I don't show him very often because it's just too scary. He was very, very calm. He was very odd for a bull because he was so calm. But all of a sudden we were getting really big calves, very vibrant. Where before when calves were born, they were so small and weak that we had to grab them and run and warm them up. Maybe give them some plaster. Medler's offspring, they hit the ground, popped right up, and started nursing. And we're like, yes! We're getting something right here. So, and we added some border collies in. And that's Katie in the background. She thinks she's the boss. We let her think that. It's Matt's. So things were going along pretty well. And I decided I needed a Jersey milk truck. So this is Molly. We like portable infrastructure. You'll see that quite often. So this is her milking stanchion. It's actually on a large pallet. You can pick it up with forks on the tractor or the skid steer and move it around. So in the summer, she's outside. In the winter, we move it inside. Makes it really easy if she poops when we milk her. You just hose it off. Not too much fun when it's raining, but she does pretty well. So Molly is still around. It's been, oh wow, 9, 10 years we've had her. She's pregnant with, I think, calf number 7. And I usually milk her inside the barn, but she's kind of retired right now. So whenever we had problems, if we had a calf that was too weak or a calf made a hand raise, we had the milk goddess. Then we decided, hey, the chickens taste so good and the beef is so good, let's try a couple pigs. So the first year we raised Porky and Petunia. The next year we did 3 more. And then the next year we did 8. And so we moved them around the pastures. We had a lot of wetlands that had been drained with drain tile, and some of that was plugged up. So we rotated them through to they could graze and stuff before we went through and repaired the drain tile. So these guys are pretty good. We could actually keep them in with one string of collar string electrified, and they behave. And we have Katie there to make sure they stay out of trouble. We tried some grass-fed lamb 1 year. We don't do lamb anymore right now. It got to be just too much, so these are the 4 that we tried 1 year. They're pretty good. They're pretty easy. Then we got into turkeys. You know, the chicken's so good, the lamb's so good, the beef's so good. Let's try some turkeys. So we did Thanksgiving turkeys. That was a big success. Then my son, who is now 15, he was probably 8 or 9. He sweet talked me like his father does into getting some ducks. So this is Willow with a bunch of her babies hatched down in our pond. And then he got Quack. So this is our son Cameron quite a bit of a while ago. We're actually in the basement of our former barn house. I was milking the cow, and Quack and Cameron would come in for conversation during milking time. Quack is a mallard white Pekin. He was hatched all by himself, and he just bonded with my son. He's still around. He's still the boss. So we'd always had some laying hens, and we were getting so many eggs. You know, those 12 baby chicks grow up, and they lay 12 eggs a day. And I figured that out really quick. And so I started selling eggs for like 25 cents a dozen. I've increased since then. And this was kind of like at the height. We probably had 80 hens that year. And we worked our way up to 120 before we actually got out of them for a bit. So we were kind of growing and growing and growing, and it never been like our ambition to be a farm. It was always like the hobby farm. We started out, we were going to grow our own food. And it just kept on growing and growing. And 26 acres with a couple creeks running through it and wetlands and stuff. We ran out of land. And we were using some hay fields nearby. And we ran into trouble with the property owners that wanted us to put manure on it or even compost or anything on it. So our hay quality was suffering. And we were building up the herd. And so we tried leasing some land. We actually worked with a cousin to lease some land, and that didn't work out. So we started looking into buying some more land nearby. And what happened at that time was there's a lot of really large dairy farms around that are milking anywhere from 300 to 1,000 cows a day. And they were just moving in and gobbling up land leases as fast as they could, $120 to $150 an acre. And so farmers were just laughing at us. They were retiring. And they leased it to these other big dairy farmers and said, you can't afford this. And they leased it to them. And so it was a tough time. And we kept on hitting wall after wall after wall. And here it was, we were growing the business. It was really taking off. We're selling all we could produce. And we're getting laughed at and joked about. And we kept on hitting it at wall after wall after wall. So we made the decision to sell. To sell the 26-acre farm with this beautiful farmhouse that we had done. Sell it, take that money, and buy something bigger. Oh, man. The rumors that went around when we started doing that. And it was really tough to convince Matt. He's the fourth generation in our area. Cameron, our son, would be the fifth generation. And it was really tough to convince him, hey, if we want to grow this business and keep what we're doing, we're either going to have to scale back or we're going to have to go for it. And luckily, he went for it. So this is what it looked like. Pretty close to probably around 10 that we decided to sell. We had some windows on the front. It's still the old original barn siding from 1874. You can see sort of at the top it had some gray underneath the eaves, so it used to be gray. So we decided we're going to spruce it up. We're going to finish this up. We're going to make this beautiful. We're going to sell it. So we had all this pine siding in storage, so Matt started putting it up. Cameron and I started painting it. We painted everything. Every building we had was painted. And if you stood still long enough, you'd get painted. I still have the shirts full of red and gray paint. So we even did a little landscaping out front. Got it all looking beautiful. And we decided, okay, it's ready. We're going to go on the market. We're going to sell it. So we put it on the market in 2009. And it didn't sell. Beginning of 2010, I started beginning my women farmers program, and I kind of went into it, you know, kind of apprehensive, skeptical, but I was really kind of hopeful. Maybe this is what we needed. Maybe this is going to give us some guidance. We can figure out where we buy something to make it really successful and actually really profitable would have ended, since we were working ourselves to the bone, but there really wasn't that much money to show for it. We had really good stakes. So I get into the program, and I find all these women, and they're dynamic, they're energetic, they're supportive, determined, all different ages and experiences, and it was just great. The program from the first class, it really made sense to me. It was like this common sense approach. We had these amazing instructors, Phil, Erica, Mary, Crystal, and they were teaching us these nifty tools that we had and already had in our toolbox. And I used to be a mechanic in the Air Force, and Matt's a mechanic, and our son is a mechanic, so we kind of understood tools and toolbox, and I really liked that comparison, so I was like, ah, tools, toolbox, yes! And so we got instructions, and really on how to use these tools that we really pretty much already had. So we got some guidance. Pretty much really every step of the way, there was always someone there. We had mentors. We had support right in the group. I mean, you showed up to class and you could tell your story and you really got the support. We had our goals, we had our testing questions. And if that wasn't, it was really motivating. And it really kept you on track. Because you'd show up at class, and there's all these women going, so how's it going? And you can ask the same thing. And they know if you avoid a question. So I was really hooked on the financial management part. See, we had been pretty successful at producing and selling all of our products, all the beef, all the chicken, all the pork, all the turkey that we could want. There just wasn't much to show for it except for freezers full for us and lots of satisfied customers. So the profit part, it wasn't doing any good. And it's really sad when you sit there in class and you know, you've just about worked your fingers to the bone and you're exhausted and you're filthy and there isn't much money in the bank to show for it. So we'd sit down and do our enterprise budget. So I thought, I'm going to do meat chickens. We've been doing them for a long time. They're really fast, they're easy. If any of you raise them, we usually only have them on the farm for 8 weeks. It's pretty easy to track your time and your expenses. So I said, all right, we're going to go for that. Because if the meat chickens can't make money, we're going to have to buy our chicken because I don't know if we were going to keep doing it. So I sat down and I did the numbers and I found out, you know, our feed costs are really high. Our mortality and our death rates, they are pretty high. Our hours were really higher. And our prices, well, they're pretty terrible. So things had to change. So I had always had this really cool way of pricing things, and some of you might still be doing it this way. Gosh, I hope not. See, I didn't want to do the math. I don't like calculators. I don't like math. I'm pretty good at math, but I don't like it. So I would just figure out, you know, go around, check online, figure out what's everybody else charging. All right, we'll do that. Maybe we'll go a little bit lower and we'll get more customers. So it's kind of cheating. Well, after I did the enterprise budget, I figured out it was really stupid. It was why we weren't making much money. And you know what? Other people were doing the same thing. So it was like this big circle of us doing the same thing. Oh, she's charging $2 a pound. I'm going to charge $2 a pound. And the next one, next one, next one. No one knew what they were what they should be charging. They didn't know what their production costs were. It was like, all right. So the ones that did have the higher prices, they knew what their costs were, and they valued their time. And I thought they were crazy. I'm like, you can't charge that much. Well, we do charge that much now. I value my time. So all these things had to change. So I learned this really neat thing in class. It's a business. And I'm the CEO. I'm the CFO. That's me, with Molly. Sometimes called the COO. She's the chief operation officer. The boss sometimes. You know, when smoking time, she's in charge. So pretty much I was in charge. Matt's there backing me up, but Matt has an off-the-farm job. I had quit all of my jobs to stay home to run this, so it was up to me. So, finances are scary. We've all been there. It's also pretty depressing, but I figured out a way. If I look at it and they're not my numbers, it's easier. So, when I sit down and do our numbers, I just remind myself, they're not my numbers, it doesn't matter. This is X, Y, and Z Corporation. It could be one of yours. It doesn't matter. I can play with the numbers and I can make them work. And it works. I had the attitude, the fear got out of it, the depression got out of it, and I felt a lot better. Things got done. So, I went through all of our expenses and stuff. You know, that inescapable and the maintenance and the wealth generating. Well, the inescapable is pretty much easy. The maintenance and the wealth generating. See, we had just been taking anything that the farm made and we invested it back into it, so it really didn't look like we were making money. So when you want to sell a farm and buy a new farm and you need the financing, it doesn't look really good on your financials if you only made $1,000 in a year and you had like maybe $28,000 worth of sales. So you have to fix that. It gets kind of embarrassing when you're looking at it going, can I just burn those records? No, I have to keep them. Oh, gosh. I had to keep looking at them, but I fixed it. So, the meat chicken operation, I can fix this. So I got really tough with it. I only have them for 8 weeks, and I had some really good records on it. So I decided, all right, what are my costs? A lot of our costs was we were buying net fencing. And net fencing from like Premier One or Pink Hook, it's phenomenal stuff. It's expensive. Well, I was like buying it. We didn't really need that much. All right, we'll just repair it when somebody rips it. So we would repair it. And then I started looking at, so why are these chickens dying? And it came down to nutrition. We were buying bad feed from like Purina, and it wasn't really all that balanced. So I started talking to other producers, found out, well, what are you feeding? And I talked to the nutritionist, the guy that works for Fertile Company, a mineral company in Pennsylvania, and I found out, you know, what his feed recipe was. And then someone said, well, why aren't you buying feed by the ton? You're doing like 500 chickens. Why buy it by the 50-pound bag? So I went to our local feed mill and I said, here's my recipe. What's it going to cost me for a ton? And so they gave me the price. And I did the math of what I had been paying for like a 50-pound bag. And I'm like, well, that's not any good. And I really negotiated. And I got tough with a guy and I said, you know, I want this. And I'll pay cash. I'm going to come here and I'm going to pick up 2,000 pounds worth of feed. And I'm going to write that check right there. You're going to have the money. I'm not going to pay with a credit card. I'm not going to put it on an account. Well, I got my price down, which was nice. So I still had the cash flow, but it saved me money. So we were turning these chickens around. We put them on this new feed the next year. And we had big, healthy, robust chickens. They're running around. I mean, these are Cornish cross chickens that people say don't run around. They don't exercise. Look at them. They're running over to me. I was getting attacked. They were healthy, vibrant, plump. We were getting higher weight gains at the same amount of time as compared to the year before. And I was like, yes, there we are. Pure profit right there. We also did a thing, there's a guy not that far from us who sold poultry supplies, and we had always bought plastic bags for him to put our chickens in. Well, he had these new things. It was called a shrink bag. So it's like when you, well, if you buy chicken at the grocery store. Well, when you're at the grocery store, look in the poultry section, and you'll see these chickens are packaged in this bag, and it shrinks right to the chicken. Well, they're thick, they're heavy, they're not cheap, but they shrink right to the chicken, and you don't get freezer burn, and they look really pretty. And so we got them, we started packaging our chickens with it, we charged to compensate for that cost, and I told my customers, hey, this is what we're doing. We've gone through our prices. Our prices aren't giving us a living wage. I was really honest with them. And I said, this is what these bags cost. I can't cover that cost. So it's going to cost you an extra like 40 cents per chicken. They bought it. They bought everything they had. We were selling out again. But I also offered an extra service. It was something that had been brought up in class. If you cut the chicken up. See, we were just selling whole chickens. Some people don't want a whole chicken. Some people don't know how to cook a whole chicken. So we were cutting them in halves, we were cutting them by legs, boneless, skinless chicken breasts. They were very popular. And we charged for that service, and we were still selling out. I was like, wow, hey, you hit on something. You be honest with the customer, you increase your prices, cover your production costs, we're golden. So I had my projected costs, and wouldn't you know, is it going to come in? Well, we had profit. This is supposed to be this profit picture thing that comes up. So we had profit. I came in over what I projected. And I was just like, you got to be kidding me. This is just awesome. I can do this to everything. And I had done it pretty much for the pigs and the turkeys. And they did pretty well. Oh, see, there's the profit. Just a little bit. So we did the pigs and the turkeys. They did pretty good. We had a couple losses of pigs that year, but a couple died. Not for our fault, but we learned from it. So it's one of those things you just go and you readjust. So I went to the beef operation. Now, they're cool. So the big mama cow there, her name's Clover. Clover was born on the farm the second year we had the calves. Her mom rejected her, and actually her mom had rejected the calf the year before. So when she rejected this calf, that cow got called. And she should have been called the year before. Now we're a little more picky. So we have Clover. Clover's on, she's like the model cow. Go, hey Clover, somebody wants to come meet you. She come over and get a picture taken. She posed. The big guy there with the straight horns, the number 17, that was her calf. Big red, you know, like big red Clover. And that was her little girl, Shasta. So we had experimented with some stuff. The black cow there is a Jersey Dexter that I tried to make into a milk cow. If you ever want to get a Jersey Dexter milk cow, think twice, call me. She was very stubborn. She wanted to be a beef cow. She busted the milking stanchion. You know, that nice outdoor one I showed that Molly was in? Yeah, she busted it in pieces. Had to rebuild it. So, Cleo ended up, okay, Cleo doesn't want to be milked, the Dexter Jersey. So, she raised up her calf. We ended up selling her calf. Like, all right, we'll keep Cleo around. But really, she was a sweet looking cow. She was very, very beefy. So she was going to be beef. And then we had tried some Herefords. So one year, Molly, my milk cow, had her calf was a stillborn. And I called around to some dairy farms to see if I could find a calf. And I got really lucky. The guy down the road that we had originally bought George and Betsy from had a day-old Hereford calf that the mom had died. So that was him. So we had raised up that Hereford calf on Molly's milk. 18 months later, he was the same size as a 30-month-old Highlander calf. So he's a whole year younger, he's the same size. The light bulb went on. Huh. These guys are really slow growing, and this guy is really fast growing. Maybe we should be looking at something different. So. So around that time, we decided, you know, well, it was for sale then. So the farm's for sale. And I finished class. The farm's still for sale. I became mentor for year two. I was the farm mentor with no farm. Kind of depressing. Nothing was working out. Well, in December 2010, we sold the farm. And it almost didn't go through. We really didn't think it was going to go through. It actually fallen apart at Thanksgiving. Well, 2 weeks before Christmas, we had to close it. We had no place to go. We've been looking at farms and looking at farms, dozens of farms. Nothing was working out. So we bought this. It's a 38-foot camper trailer. And it's not a new one either. So not much insulation. It's December 2010. Remember that winter? Lots of snow, lots of cold. So we bought that. We moved it a half mile up the road in the hayfield behind Matt's parents. And we moved in. Me, Matt, Cameron, four dogs. We sent the cat to my mom's. And so we parked it up there. We put up some fence. We moved the cows up there. 7.5 months in 380 square feet. It wasn't fun. We paid $4,500 for it, and we figured, you know, it's a good deal. We can sell it for probably that much whenever we move. So, 7.5 months, just think of that. The air conditioning worked really well in July. So the end of July, we finally closed on 150-acre farm. That's it. It's here, nice alfalfa field. Phil Metzger and I went out there one nice hot fall day and threw darts across that whole field. It's an alfalfa field. We hit one alfalfa plant. They're like trees, they choke out everything else. We also found out we had lots of moss. Capping, mature capping. Beautiful alfalfa field, very nutritious, lots of capping. But all of our sacrifice had worked out. The financial planning had worked out. See, we went to the bank after we sold, showed them the bank account at the credit union where I deposited the big check. Said, see, we got equity. How much money could we get? Of course, I had to pull out the schedule F's for the past 3 years and show zero, then $1,000, then $10,000 pure profit. It's like, yeah, okay, see? See that training I was talking about? See? It showed up on the IRS form for our Schedule F. It's legal. We showed a profit. Come on. And they really liked it. They didn't even look at our business plan. We showed them rock-solid financials. I even showed them my certificate from the graduating class. Now, it's a local bank that we had a farm account with. When we got, right before we got married and we were going to build into the barn house, nobody would give us money. This bank gave us a $10,000 loan. The bank manager, her daughter, cuts my hair, you know, like every once in a while, not very often. So there was a little bit of a family relation, kind of, you know, we knew each other and stuff. That bank manager, I see her like every week when I'm in depositing checks and stuff. She always asks me, so how, Trish, how do you like the farm? I'm like, it's awesome. It gets better. So we moved in the end of July. No hay had been cut. It's the end of July. Everyone else is doing their second cutting. We're doing our first cutting. It doesn't look so green, does it? So it was alfalfa that had matured, but we're going to cut it anyways. At the time, you know, when we made the offer on the farm, we had 16 head. Two went to the butcher right when we moved, and four more were slated for butchering that year. So we were going into winter with 10 cows. We had a steer die from alfalfa bloat beginning of September. Learning curve is not fun, even when you've been doing this a long time. Our bull died of old age in the fall. Yeah, the nice big studly guy, the big black one with the horns. Yeah, it was fine one day. We actually had some women from class two that were out. We were butchering chickens. See, when you're a mentor, you can call up your mentees and say, hey, we're butchering 300 chickens. You want to come learn? They come over and help. Showed them the bull. Bull was doing fine. Well, the next morning, dead. Okay. So, we were going into winter with only 8 animals. Two only were mature cows, so everybody else was young. We took 1,200 bales off the field. We used to only make 1,200 bales in a whole year. This was one cutting. We filled the hay wagon, what, 4 times? I'm like, they're still coming? We only own one hay wagon. We need more. So, what did we get? Well, the other lab is my son's Labrador, Sarah. So, at the end of our fields, it kind of drops off, and it goes into some woods. There's a creek through it. Pretty darn nice. Got some meadows. So, the border collie going down the trail is my dog, Bandit. There's pigs way in the far background. You can see a little bit of their fence in their hut. There's Molly in the field. She poses really well. This is the fall. So, it's really sweet. It's really nice. We really, really love it. I get up every morning and I can sit in my front window and look what we've got. So, it's really, really nice. I can't say that enough. Everybody asks me, how's the farm? I'm like, oh, it's nice. I kind of miss it a little. So, from now on, we're going to build the herd back, our beef herd, slowly. We're going to do it carefully. We're not going to make these rash decisions and buy animals because they're cool looking. We have a goal. The beef herd will pay for itself. It pays for itself now. It is not profitable. One of the goals with buying the larger farm was so we could manage grass better and we could raise cows into January if we wanted to. Actually, if we'd gotten in earlier, we probably never would have feed hay this winter. We'd still be grazing. Well, they're grazing right now, but it could work out really well. We could have like zero hay costs and we make our own hay. So really, pretty soon we might not need a tractor. Imagine that. A bunch of mechanics without a tractor. It'd be fun. We could get a horse by then. So, Matt still has his off-the-farm job. I get to go around and do farm visits sometimes. We got a really good location. We're about a half mile from a lake that has 500 camps on it. 500 potential customers. Matt said that the other day, and I was like, yeah, 500. See, I thought there was 300 camps, 500. And we started selling as soon as we moved in last July, and they found us, a couple dozen of them. We've done a little bit of advertising and stuff. They're finding us, but they're gonna really find us. This is when Phil came out. We had to throw those darts, sell that alfalfa. We did find some grass. It's really not what I want to see. I want to be able to look at that picture and find at least 10 different things. I'm not finding it. So this is a picture from our back field. This is about when we moved in. So I'm 5 foot tall. There's some stuff this tall. I was like, I'm going to get lost. I need to ride the four-wheeler. But we got it grazed. We're actually, right now, overgrazing a bit. We're trying to kill off the alfalfa so we can let the orchard grass and the clovers and stuff come in. So, I can honestly say planned profit works. Financial management works. And if more farmers had a holistic goal and they actually managed towards it, I look at the dairy farmers that we used to deal with. These dairy farmers who used to say, you can't make it in farming, you're not going to make any money in farming, and nobody's going to pay that much. Well, they had to drive by to make sure we had it. So it's really nice. And when I've mentioned to some of them, so what's your goal? I mean, these are guys that are in their 60s, they've been farming for as far as they can remember. They're like, a goal? What are you talking about? I'm a dairy farmer. I'm like, oh, come on. Don't you want something out of your life? Every single one of their kids left the farm. Every single one of them. Some of them went to the West Coast. Some of them in like Aspen, Colorado, skiing for a living. They don't want to come near the farm. You've got a 15-year-old son. He loves the farm. Makes you a little nervous because you don't want to pressure him to stay. But we're training him up. So no matter what he does, he's going to have some really good financial skills. So we are a diversified, nurturing, land healing grazing farm. We love what we do. We take great pride in producing healthy, nutritious food for our local customers that is raised in a kind and healthy environment. And we're really proud to be stewards of our land. We absolutely love sharing the farm and showing by example what good stewardship and management can do. And actually, you know, it got us our dream. It got us even a little bit more. And I can honestly say, it's really cool to say this, we practice holistic management and it really works. Thank you.